Hello friends, and welcome to our channel RN Online Tutorials. In our previous sessions, we have seen in general overview of the inflammation. What are the types of inflammation? What are their characteristic features? In this session, we are going to learn in detail about acute inflammation, its process and what happens to it.
Before that, if you have not subscribed to our channel, please do subscribe to our channel and also hit the bell icon so that you will get regular updates about our upcoming videos.
Okay. So acute inflammatory can be divided into the following two events. Okay, the first one is a vascular event and the second one is a cellular event. So there are two events, vascular and cellular events. Okay, so these events we are going to see in details. So first one is a vascular event. So alteration in the microvasculature, that is arterioles, capillaries and venules, is the earliest response to the tissue injury. So whenever any kind of tissue injury is there, so we have seen acute inflammation is a local response to the tissue injury. So whenever any kind of tissue injury is there, that time what happened? First step is a alteration in microvasculature, that is arterioles, capillary and venules. So these are the microvascular, these are the end terminal of any artery or veins. So what happens? There is a earliest response to tissue injury to these structures. Okay. So these alteration include hemodynamic changes and changes in the vascular permeability. So what are these changes? We are going to see in details. Okay, so first one is a hemodynamic changes. So first there will be transient vasoconstriction. So first, after the any injury, there will be first response will be there will be vasoconstriction. Okay? After immediate vasoconstriction, transient word itself suggests that it is for very short duration. Okay, just for few seconds. So after transient vasodilation, vasoconstriction, there will be persistent progressive vasodilation. So there will be persistent vasodilation, means the vessels will start dilating. Okay. Then there will be elevation of the local hydrostatic pressure, because of vasodilatation, there will be elevation in the local hydrostatic pressure. Then slowing or stasis of microcirculation, and at the end there will be leukocyte migration. So this process we are going to see in details. Okay. So first one is a transient vasoconstriction. So what happens here? Immediate vascular response is of transient vasoconstriction of arterioles with the, so if you will see in this picture, there is a vascular response to the vasoconstriction. So if you will see, the vessels will get constricted, and with the milder form of injury, the blood flow may be re-established in 3 to 5 seconds. While with the more severe injury, the vasoconstriction may last for 5 minutes. So as I have said, transient means it is for very less span of time. So that may be seconds to minutes. So if you will see, 3 to 5 seconds in mild injury and up to 5 minutes in severe form of injury. So there will be transient vasoconstriction. Okay. Now the second one is a persistent progressive vasodilatation. So what happened? It involves mainly the arterioles to lesser extent affect the venules and capillary. So it involves mainly arterioles, and to lesser extent it affect the venules and capillary. So arterioles are mainly supplying the blood to that particular area, and venules and capillary are taking blood away from that particular area. Okay, so it mainly involves the arterioles. That means there will be increased blood supply, arteries will be dilated. Okay, this result in the increased blood volume in the microvascular bed of that area. So as I have said, there will be increased blood supply and increased blood volume in the microvascular bed of that particular area. So which is responsible for the redness and the warmth at the site of the acute inflammation. So if you will see, if there is an increased blood supply in that particular area and the blood is not taking away by the veins and capillary, so what happened? Blood will accumulate there, and there will be increased redness because of the red color of the blood, and there will be redness and warmth because of the collection of the blood. Okay. So next is a progressive vasodilation also elevate the local hydrostatic pressure, resulting in the transudation of the fluid into the extracellular space. This is responsible for swelling at the local site of acute inflammation. So because of this vasodilatation, what happened? The local hydrostatic pressure increases. So we have seen, the blood will come and stay there. It is not taking away by the veins. Okay, so because of that, there will be increased hydrostatic pressure. That means increased pressure of the water that is there in the blood. So that result in transudation of the fluid into the extracellular space. So from the intracellular space, the blood or the transudation of the fluid, that is because of the increased hydrostatic pressure, that fluid will transude it into the extracellular spaces, that is outside the cavity. So because of that, that is responsible for the swelling at the local site of the inflammation. So we have seen the signs of inflammation in our previous session, that is redness, warmth, swelling, pain. So this is all three we have seen, that is because of the increase progressive vasodilatation. So there will be redness, there will be warmth, and there will be swelling. Okay, so this is how it happens. So this is a normal phenomenon, if you will see. So here hydrostatic pressure is normal. Okay, but if you will see in this picture, in acute inflammation, so there will be increase in the oncotic pressure and the vasodilatation. So because of vasodilatation, there will be increased flow in this area, and that fluid will come out from these cavities, and it will come out of the extracellular spaces, and there will be edema or swelling. In this normal picture, there is a normal flow and no vasodilatation. If you will see, this vessel is dilated. So because of that, there is a edema or transudation is there. Here there is no transudation and there is no edema, because this is normal scenario. This is inflammatory scenario. So we are going to see this picture again in our further sessions. Okay, so next step is a slowing or stasis of the microcirculation, which causes increased concentration of the red cells, and thus it raises the blood viscosity. Okay, so because of the slowing or stasis of the microcirculation, so blood is coming from the arteries are already dilated, veins are not dilated, veins are at the normal shape. So the blood, increased amount of blood which is brought by the arteries is not taken up by the veins, so there will be slowing or stasis of the circulation. Okay, which causes increased concentration of the red blood cells, and thus it increase the blood viscosity. Okay, because we have seen fluid, if you will see, fluid is taken away by the transudation, so ultimately what remains in the injurious area, that is a red blood cells, because fluid is already gone away, it is in the extracellular spaces, out of extracellular spaces, but blood cells are still there, so there will be increase in the viscosity of the blood. So stasis or slowing is followed by leukocytic migration, that are mainly neutrophils. So leukocytes are the white blood cell, that is our immune cells. Okay, so immune cells will migrate at the acute inflammation area, and the leukocytes stick to the vascular endothelium briefly, and then move and migrate through the vascular endothelium. Okay, so this process is known as immigration. About immigration we are going to see in details in our further sessions. Okay, so the leukocyte will come, and the endothelial leukocyte will come and stick to the vascular endothelium, and then move and migrate through them. Okay, so this process is known as immigration. So this is all about the vascular event. Then we will see the altered vascular permeability. So in this, around the inflamed tissue, there is a accumulation of the edema. So we have seen how the edema is formed. In the initial stages, the escape of fluid is due to the vasodilatation and consequent elevation of the hydrostatic pressure. This is a transudate in nature. So initial state we have seen, the escape of fluid is due to the vasodilatation. We have seen in our previous, in this video only, we have seen that how the vasodilatation is occurring and how the video is, how the fluid is getting transudated. Okay, so that is because of the elevation in the hydrostatic pressure. So this is transudate in nature. But subsequently, the characteristic inflammatory edema exudate appears by increased vascular permeability of the microcirculation. So after some time or some duration, there will be characteristic inflammatory edema, so exudate appears. So what is the difference between transudate and exudate is, Transudate is clear fluid, whether exudate is a fluid which contains cells, so it is not clear. So, we will see about the Starling's hypothesis. So, what Starling hypothesis is? The fluid buoyancy is maintained by the two opposing sets of forces. The forces that causes outward movement of fluid from the microcirculation. So, these are intravascular hydrostatic pressure and colloid osmotic pressure of interstitial fluid. So, first force is outward movement of fluid from the microcirculation, that is the intravascular hydrostatic pressure, colloid osmotic pressure and colloid osmotic pressure of interstitial fluid. Okay, forces that causes inward movement of interstitial fluid from into circulation. So, these are intravascular colloid osmotic pressure and hydrostatic pressure of interstitial fluid. So, what are the two forces? Outward movement of fluid from microcirculation, those are intravascular hydrostatic pressure and colloid osmotic. And force that cause inward movement of interstitial fluid are intravascular colloid osmotic pressure and hydrostatic pressure. Okay, so here it is intravascular hydrostatic pressure and colloid osmotic pressure. Here it is intravascular colloid osmotic pressure and hydrostatic pressure in interstitial fluid. Okay, whatever little fluid is left in the interstitial compartment is drained away by the lymphatics and thus no edema result normally. So, in inflamed tissue, the endothelial lining of the microvasculature becomes more leaky. Okay? Because of the inflammation, the endothelial lining of microvasculature becomes leaky. So, there will be leak. Okay? Consequently, intravascular colloid osmotic pressure decreases. So, osmotic pressure of the interstitial fluid increases, resulting in excessive outward flow of fluid into the interstitial compartment, which is exudative inflammatory edema. So, we will see again this picture which we have seen. Okay. So, if you will see here, this is hydrostatic pressure, this is osmotic pressure, this is hydrostatic pressure. Okay. So, if you will see, the pressure is moving from here it is 32, here it is 25, here it is 12. So, pressure is, so the flow is from the high pressure to the low pressure as a rules of physics. But if you will see here the hydrostatic pressure is normal, but because of the vasodilatation, the oncotic pressure is decreased. If you will see here, it is decreased. So, because of the decreased pressure here and increased osmotic oncotic pressure in the extracellular compartment, this flow from here, it will be leak into the extravascular space and there will be movement of fluid from intravascular space to the extravascular space. Here if you will see, oncotic pressure is normal, tissue tension is normal. So, the flow is intravascular, but here the vessel become leaky and the fluid will come out from the vessel because of the decrease in the oncotic pressure and inside the vessel and increase in the oncotic pressure outside the vessel. So, because of this opposite forces, the fluid from here, it will come out and it will be exudative in nature, so that it will be containing the blood cells and pus cells, that is WBC. So, that will be exudative in the nature. So, this was all about the acute inflammation. So, what we have learned today is the acute inflammation, the two event, that is vascular event and cellular event. In vascular event, we have seen what are the hemodynamic changes. This vasoconstriction, then vasodilatation, then elevation of the hydrostatic pressure, then stasis, then leukocyte migration. Then after that, we have seen altered vascular permeability. In that, we have seen Starling hypothesis and the representative picture, that how the edema is formed and how the transudation and exudation occurs. This is all about today's session. So, if you like our video, please like, share and subscribe to our channel and hit that bell icon, and also don't forget to give your feedback in our comment section. Thank you.